Check. 1, 2, 1, 2.
Books.
Check.
Mm-hmm.
Check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Check 1, 2.
Last question. Do you have a clicker?
No? Pointer I don't have. You'll have to use the mouse on the keyboard.
No problem. No problem. Uh-huh. Oh, no problem. Okay. Okay. Well, it's time to start. And first, let me introduce myself. My name is Yury Sumarokov. I'm a medical doctor. I'm working at the Northern State Medical University in Northwest Russia. This is the place where I come from. It's the yellow star. We have the big medical school, the northernmost medical school in Russia. This is our university area where we getting the students and sending them back. Every year we have graduation about 300 physicians, so it's a big school. And not only physicians, but also psychologists, dentists, nurses. Masters of public health, and many, many other specialties related to medicine, including biochemistry, medical biologists, for example, pharmacists. So it's a hard work. My background is a medical doctor. I graduated the same school. I was working 15 years approximately in the rural area, not so far from this point, somewhere here. It's 600 kilometers from the city. And my family belong to another region. My grandmother, she was indigenous Nenets, and grandfather too. And they were living in tundra, where my father was growing before he entered the school. He was living in tundra and also moving with reindeers. All the family was reindeer herders. Reindeer herding is the main occupation of our indigenous Nenets. It's a big indigenous nation. In terms of Russia, it's the biggest one. So I'll tell you a bit later about these habits and the mental health issues related to the Nenets people too. So around 10% of total population living in the Arctic are belonging to the indigenous groups. So we can calculate around 40 ethnical, different ethnic groups in the areas of the Arctic coastline. You see the different colors here. The brown color is the territory where Nenets are living. Then to the east you have another nations from the coastline of Canada. It's a blue color. Blue color is mostly Inuits. So we have many, many connections, common features, and the same problems. Not so many geographical connections, but very many health connections. And not only in the Arctic you can find high suicide rate. It's a worldwide problem, even now. Indigenous people in all the places, in many places of the world, they have quite very high suicide rates, and especially in the areas of Canada, Norway, Sweden, area related to Sami population, how we call Sapmi. It's four countries. In fact, Sapmi is a territory of Sami where people are living without any borders, how they think, and it's true. So not so many Sami are living in Russia. Most of them are in Finland, Sweden, and Norway. We had a meeting with Sami in January this year under the roof of Arctic Council, because Finland now is a chairman of the Arctic Council, and they have a lot of discussions on suicide and suicide prevention in Sami population. In Australia, Aborigines in Australia are over-researched in suicide, over-researched. It's too much papers. If you click suicide prevention in Indigenous community, in 80% you will get papers from Australia. Native Americans in the United States, Maoris in New Zealand, which is also a problem in this territory. Inuits in Greenland, they have the highest rate in the world. And it was the first nation reported on suicide, high suicide rates. The first nation from the world was the first group in the world was Inuits from Canada, from Greenland. Yes. The first paper, as we know, came around the year 1972-71. Brazilian indigenous people. I'm talking mostly about Guarani, because Guarani, they have the highest rate in Latin America. And the Fijians, which is unexpected, because Fiji is a bright place where people expect happiness. Sun is shining. It's a resort from my point of view. And you're feeling like feeling Hakuna Matata feeling. Yes? Nothing disturbing. No anxiety, no depression. No suicidal behavior, but Fijians commit suicide, and much more often than non-indigenous people in Fiji. In Russia, our indigenous groups are distributed all over the country. You can find them not only in the north, but also all over the Siberia. Quite a lot of indigenous groups are living in the Far East, the Far Eastern coast. So, and all of them are belonging to 40 different ethnical groups, 42. We calculate 42. According to the Russian law legislation, the nation called indigenous, if these people have their own language, culture, traditional lifestyle, territory, and the number is small, means not exceeding 50,000 people. So, but Nenets group is growing. And we have very good birth rate. And we should exceed 50,000. What will happen next? Nobody knows. Because they're getting the benefits from the state. It's an indigenous group which is beneficial and well supported. So this is a traditional cloth of Nenets, mostly made from furs. Yeah, it's a reindeer fur. And the furs of wild animals you can find. The most popular animal in tundra, in Nenets tundra, is polar fox. Very nice fur. Very good. Russia was a Yeah, this diagram, you just look to the colors, because I will explain you. All the situation with suicide in Russia was depending on the leadership. There were many political connections. For example, starting from the Second World War, suicide rate was growing and growing and growing during the leadership of Khrushchev, Brezhnev, Andropov, and other Soviet leaders. It was growing up to the end of the pre-Gorbachev time, let's call. When Gorbachev came, he introduced dry law all over the country. It was anti-alcohol policy, very strict anti-alcohol policy, and suicide rate dropped down. It's a well-known phenomenon. We have got high birth rate in a year, one of the highest in Europe, drop in mortality, and suicidal rate. That was a phenomenon well known in public health. But then, let's call it freedom come, and after that, we have got market economy. Everybody could sell vodka, alcohol in the amount he wanted, so there was uncontrolled market. And immediately, line was raising up, and up to 41.7 per 100,000, which is a terribly high rate, one of the highest in the world at that time, probably the highest. We and Lithuania were the leaders in the world in the 90s. In 90s, it was top on 1994, and then slightly went down. Now we have rate about in a country we have about 14 per 100,000 last year, which is moderate. You know, in Canada you have 10. In most of the European countries, between 10 and 13 per 100,000, so it's also the moderate rates, but it's very different in the regions. When you look to the regions, especially indigenous territories, situation is totally different. Our indigenous people expected the same thing like in America, so they were colonized. Maybe not many people know about it, but I just want to add only a few words on this history. It happened in approximately in 15th century when Russian traders, merchants came from the south, the taxes were introduced. This tax is called yasak in local language. So you should pay once a year, 1/10 of your property, approx, in different materials, not in money, but furs, mostly furs. And gold sometimes, so it depends. And nobody wants to pay taxes, and of course indigenous nenets also, and they start to fight. Even the city, which was established as a trade center in the north, in the territory of nenets, Pustozersk, he was burned around 10 times. Now it's not existing yet. The city disappeared in our difficult historical time. It was inhabited mostly by old believers. You know, old believing is was very strong force opposing the official Orthodox Church in that time, and old believers moved to the north. They escaped. Then they escaped to America also to Canada, to US, to Alaska, for example. So, but now we still have communities of old believers in the north, especially in the capital of Nenets, in Narianmar, we also have old believers. Then colonization continued to the east, and Chukotka was colonized approximately in 17th century. But military conflict stopped only at the end of 18th century in the Arctic. 19th century was a period of Christianization. Christianity was introduced, and the Nenets became Christians. Unfortunately, it wasn't a slight way and wrong and clean way also. It was in some places it was forced. But Nenets still believe, they believe in Christ, of course, they are Christians, but they have their own believings, spiritual believings. For example, our people connect very many thoughts, feelings with nature. They believe in spirits of lakes, trees, animals, upper world, lower world. But of course, they believe in Creator as the main thing which is existing in the world. So it probably makes them more loyal to official Christian Orthodox Church. In Soviet time, then in 19th century, there was another disaster. It's trade colonization. Traders brought a lot of alcohol for illegal trade. It was used very often, and it created alcohol problems, a lot of cases of violence, homicides, and suicides too. The problem started in the 19th century, especially at the end of 19th century. In Soviet time, another problem was created. It's collectivization and forced settlement. So traditional lifestyle of Nenets is nomadic lifestyle. They live in the families. They don't have chiefs and tribes. And family doesn't mean that you are the relatives. You just live together and work together. There are a few families. Now it is this system returned back, and we call it family tribal community. Family tribal community. When several families are working together, taking care of ranges and moving across tundra. In Soviet time, this system was destroyed. Yes, please interrupt me. They speak both. I never told you about the language. Our Nenets people, in 60%, they use Nenets language at home and everywhere, but also fluently speak Russian because of the school education. Even in the primary school, it's introduced Russian language. But indigenous language, for example, Nenets language, it's a second language in the indigenous school. So it is also introduced in a school education, but only in the territory of their living. If they move to the city, for example, they don't have this ability. They can get knowledge only from the parents, no other way. But 60% approx are speaking very often. It's just a normal thing. And it's supported now. It's supported to have, and it's very good, I like it. Language is the main source, is the shortest way to your brain in terms of the suicide prevention. Native language is the main, one of the main protective instruments in suicide prevention. So moving further, can I continue? Well, moving further, forced settlement was also a disaster. Because when you brought to the settlement, artificial, it wasn't existing before, so it was organized, and these villages were built mostly after the Second World War in 50s. The idea was to bring better lifestyle, to bring quality of life to the family, because they live in non-appropriate conditions, how authorities were thinking. So living in the tent, in this chum, how we called tipi, it's inappropriate. It's something wrong. So we should improve their life condition. We should bring them houses, and the better housing maybe will change their life relatively. But it moves people from the traditional work, from the nomadic work, from work from for herding work, and it also create problems of. People forced to settle, to live in the place where they probably don't like to stay for a long time, but they need. And they mostly were doing nothing in this settlement because they were reindeer herders. They should spend their half a year, between the periods of reindeer herding activity, they stay in the settlement, and they drink a lot, and they commit suicides. In post-Soviet time, another disaster came. It's oil and gas expansion. Companies coming from all over the world, Russian, American, even Vietnamese, they're working in the area. And oil and gas companies are taking the lands and they pollute this territory very much. Now we consume reindeer meat, but we are not suggesting, as a physicians, we are not suggesting to eat reindeer liver and kidneys. Because we have got last samples last year, and it will be published soon, that in most of the reindeer, kidneys, kidney and liver is polluted by mercury. And not meat, not so much. Meat is okay. Meat is quite good. But organs, especially kidney, liver, which is tasty, but it's not allowed to eat more. Summing up all the effects of colonization, we can't list it. It's a huge list of different problems. But summing in the three big groups, probably it's the main. Effects on mental health, on physical and health services. On mental health is psychological distress, depression, addictive behavior, and suicides. Among the people forced to settle, people with destroyed traditional lifestyle, people living in a non-traditional atmosphere, like in urban area, for example. Indigenous people expect depression and psychological distress more often than in a traditional tundra. So, effects on physical health, which is connected with dietary changes. Traditional diet of Nenets is protein fat. More than one half of ratio should be protein and fat. Means reindeer meat, fish, mostly. And less amount of, for example, bread, noodles, carbohydrates in a smaller amount. But now situation changed in another direction. So Nenets consume much more carbohydrates than before. They eat a lot of noodles, bread. It's easy to carry. You can take dry noodles to your trip in tundra and carry for long distances, easy to carry, cheap. Cooking is very simple. So, and that created a lot of problems with obesity, diabetes, cardiovascular diseases. Before, we haven't had obesity in Nenets. In the 30s, for example, most of the men and women, they had no obesity. And even now, reindeer herders, all of them, they are quite very, they're in a good shape. You couldn't find any signs of obesity in this group of people. But now in Nenets, for example, we have another picture. We are the leaders in a country in obesity among women. Women, especially in the age of 15, 49, the obesity is very high, more than one half of the population they have. On the health services, also inequality and loss of traditional practice. We don't have knowledge on the traditional practices, especially in mental health. I'm very much interested in this issue. Even I was planning to go to Canada. It's also was an idea to look for this possibility to know more about traditional practices of local indigenous people used for mental health. We know very many stories about healing in the, for example, Navajo. Navajo, they provide their own methods of healing of schizophrenia and different other psychiatric disorders. We have no this type of care in Russia at all. We know zero about it, very little. This is our traditional diet. Kids are very happy. While they consume this fresh blood of Rady and small pieces of meat, because it's a source of vitamins, biologically active substances, it's a totally protein diet, which is very useful for the indigenous kids. My father was drinking fresh blood of Rady all his childhood, and now he is 83 and he has all his teeth in the mouth. He don't have any problems with dentists at the age of, in the age of 83 years. So it makes sense. And traditionally, Rady meat and the Rady blood is not a regular drink, of course. It's not a regular drink. It just happens when the people kill new Rady. They usually invite the kids to drink some blood. They suggest them. And they join and do it. They can put some salt and pepper if they want. And I suppose they are happy. What they don't consume, milk, any milk. Milk, because of the total distribution, about 90% of neonates, they have lactose intolerance. We discovered this not so far. There was a special research in our university. They even made a deep genetic research that neonates, especially in the third generation, they mostly have lactose intolerance in 90% approx. In more younger generation, in mixed families, for example, the prevalence of lactose intolerance is lower. It depends. So, summing up, why we need to know about these food changes, because it moves to the alcohol abuse very fast. If people consume carbohydrate diet, traditional people, indigenous people, are much more related to alcohol abuse. This is one of the reasons. Our Center of Arctic Research in Nadim, they made an interesting research on the issues of distribution. There was a hypothesis that alcohol dehydrogenase, which is the main ferment responsible for metabolism of alcohol in your body, is lower in the indigenous population. That's why maybe they are more related for development of alcohol abuse. But in fact, they have the same level, which was discovered. Same level like any other people living in the West and South. So, something wrong with diet. On the top of the world in suicides, you can find these five regions. It's Greenland, number one, Nunavut, number two, and Nenets, number three. Nenets Autonomous Okrug, how we call it in Russian, NAO, a region where we are working. Chukotka is number four in the Far East, and Alaska number five. Both neighbors. All the territories with high proportion of indigenous population. In Russia, it also depends on the proportion of indigenous population. When you look to the average suicide rates in 25-year period, the highest rates are in the areas where proportion of indigenous is high. Nenets, Chukotka, Taimyr. And it's rather low in the areas where it is not so high proportion, lower proportion of indigenous. So they produce this problem mostly. So the area where we are working, this is Nenets Autonomous Okrug and Arkhangelsk, which is mostly Russian territory. And it's easy to compare what's happening in both populations. In neighboring populations living in the same area. This is one of the disasters. This is a territory of traditional Rady herding in Nenets area. And here you see a lot of oil and gas mines. These points. It's not enough. Now you can find much more points. This map is not the fresh one. It was created approximately 10 years ago. But now the number of sites is bigger, much bigger. But even this map is showing the scale of this problem. One of the examples on site, for example, one of the forced settlement established in 1956 approximately after the Second World War, with population of 1,600, and most of the population are indigenous Nenets, reindeer herders. So every year, suicides are registered, completed suicides, 1, 2, 3 per year. Suicidal attempts, we don't know exactly how many, because this is hidden. This information is unavailable, even in a small settlement where everybody knows. And 100%, all of them were indigenous Nenets, and all of them were heavily drunk prior to committing suicide. They were heavily drunk. So 100% of blood alcohol content positive cases. You see rather gray and dark territory. Even the photo is very depressive from my point of view. So we were asked by the community, by the local health leaders, we should discover the reasons why people commit suicide more often in Nenets, and we should start on this basis, we should start our prevention campaign. What to do? Of course, we before starting any research with indigenous people, you should knock the door. If the door is opening, you're welcome. If door is not opening, community decide. You are not allowed to start. So, and that was done. First question was asked, who commits suicide in the Nenets? What kind of people? What is the target group? Then another question, how and when they commit suicide? In order to start prevention, we should know these details. What methods used? What methods are used? When it happened more often? What time of the year? What day of the week? Then, why people in Nenets commit suicide more often than in neighboring territory in Arkhangelsk, living in the same condition, people? So we collected many, many data, all cases of suicide in the area, all population data from censuses in order to get socio-demographic characteristic of the people committing suicide. All cases from Russia, you can't imagine. In Russia, we have more than 500,000 suicide per 10 year. It's more than in war. Any war, you can't compare. It's terrible. It's like a pandemic. But that was, and it is. Now the figures are lower, of course, if you collect all the cases of suicide from all over the country. But we have got this data. For our research, it was needed to know the basement. Probably it's the first time in the country when we have all this data set in one hand. It wasn't so easy, but we have got it from a very interesting place, which is called Max Planck Institute. They have everything. Yeah, they have even Russian group working there, Russian demographers, very nice people. And we collected all the cases of suicide from Arkhangelsk region, from the territory which is mostly Russian. So then we put different variables in each case and start working. So for the first question, answer is here. Who commits suicide? It's mostly Nenets, 90 per 100,000, comparing with 49, the rate is twice higher than in non-indigenous. The youngest ages, especially male between 20-29, and female between 30-39, and we look for this diagram, you see who is making the main input for suicidal mortality in the area and what is the target group we should work. The target group are the young males, young indigenous males. How things were happening later, you see all the rates in it's a different regions of the Russian Arctic. I just need to stress your attention on these two diagrams. This is quite going well, so in the different regions of Arctic, suicide rate is going down from year to year. But in Nenets, for example, it's not it wasn't going down even in this century. There was a growth of suicide, especially we had huge rate in 2008, more than 100 per 100,000 in the area. So in males it was 170 approx. In females lower, but in females it's another situation. You see this upper diagram, it's Chukotka. Chukotka is demonstrated now in opposite figures. They have stable suicide rate among the females, and nobody knows why. Everywhere suicide rate is going down, but not in female in Chukotka. We ask this question, discuss this question also with our partners from another side of Bering Strait, from Alaska. Same type of population, same ethnical group are living on both sides of Bering Strait. But situation is different. They don't have these dynamics like we have, for example. When it happened, it's mostly in spring, as we know, right? But month is different. Month is different. For Russian population, for non-indigenous population, suicides happen more often in May. And when we look to the day of the week, it's mostly Monday. Monday is the most terrible day. But in Nenets, in Nenets population, it's mostly on Friday. And the spring month is also different, April. And it probably depends on the local holidays and the reindeer herding festivals, when people meet each other, drink a lot, violence, suicide and homicides are quite very often. So next, there is also another peak in September, unexpected result, I don't know why. September is always a heavy period of time. It's probably connected also with some movement from traditional movement, from summer pastures to winter sites. Reindeer are living in the south. During the winter time, they move to the forest where winds are not so strong. In summer, in the opposite way, they move to the north and to the hills where winds are stronger and you expect less mosquitoes and flies. It's much more comfortable to stay in summer. But methods also different, you see. 69% of henning among males, it's lower than in the country. But 86% among female is higher than in the country. Guns are used much more often because everybody has guns, everybody has rifles. Weapons are quite very popular thing in a hunting territory especially. Most of the Nenets are hunters. So, and it's also one of the reasons why they don't want to contact with psychiatrists. They're always afraid to lose their licenses for hunting. If they will come to the register, for example, for addiction, or mental disease, they're automatically losing the hunting license and even the driving license too. But hunting first. Same with cats, you see, because everybody has knife. Knife is not a weapon. In tundra, it's a fork and spoon together. You saw from the picture with kids. The kids are also using knife. Even the small kids. Otherwise, they will not get any food because knife is used during this eating of fresh reindeer meat. It's like a fork. And third question, why people commit suicide more often in the territory of now than in Arkhangelsk, neighboring territory? Probably this is the reason. We have all the cases of suicide investigated in the forensic laboratory. It's a rule. It's obligatory rule in Russia to have forensic analysis of each case of suicide with blood alcohol content, with other instrumental and laboratory investigations completed, because it's controlled by prosecutor according to the law. So that's why the sample was enough to make a conclusion that 78% of men and 92% of women were committing suicide heavily drunk, with very high proportion of alcohol in blood. It's more than 2 promille. It's very high. In a non-indigenous area, it's much lower. It's less than half among women, approximately one half among men. In all over the Russia, we have approximately 50-55%. A bit lower than 50 among the population. In general sample, less than half commit suicide being drunk. This table I like very much. It was made in Canada. It's your production, ITK. So several levels of influence, several levels of risk factors, and several levels of protective factors. You can choose what you want. For example, on personality level, what kind of the risk factors are relevant for concrete territory, for community? We just list them, then define the protective factor relevant for these people. What kind of the protective factor? Of course, on the national level, we have historical trauma, forced relocation, other historical terrible events as main risk factor. And as a protective factor, we can choose cultural continuity, language skills, culture, and history, which protect indigenous population quite well. Shut down. Yeah.
Time out.
Maybe.
Okay.
So I will continue a bit. So what is the main forcing mechanisms of protection? Of course, it's language. Language. When we keep our language, when we use language as one of the methods of communication in the community, it better works in suicide protection too. Just waiting.
Yeah.
Okay. So we can define protective factor in each level you have seen. So for example, for conditional level, in the exact condition, we usually have, for example, guns, rifles, and knives. We can't remove them. In a Randy Hurden society, it's impossible. It's impossible. It's not only a source of hunting, but it's also a source of survival for Randy Hurdens living in tundra. It protects them from wild animals like polar bear, for example. A polar bear now is living very actively. They more and more disturbing our settlements. This year it was a terrible disaster in Novaya Zemlya, in new land in the Arctic. So many visits of polar bear never expected before. Because of melting, they come in closer and closer to humans, and we can't shoot them, it's prohibited. It's very serious crime. So in Russia, you can only make them run away somewhere in some sorts of the activity, I don't know. So we can only restrict access to alcohol and drugs in this level, only, no other way. On personality level, it's an access to ethnicity-specific mental health, which is very good thing, but we know very little about it. We even know nothing, probably. I know only one shaman in Nenets, his name is Kolya. He's providing some kind of the worships. He tried to help people, but he is not doing it in a professional way, just, like a hobby. And he does not have any contact with local health professionals too. He's not involved so much in the ethnicity-specific mental health care. So religion also a good instrument, but you know, Nenets religion is so complicated, so difficult to find the Nenets people always talking with spirits. Even they're in a church, they're thinking about spiritual things. So they connect spirituality, traditional beliefs with Christianity. And it's very complicated boil. Supportive family with traditional life and native language environment. In a family, we usually get everything. So if we talk in the same language with mother, father, with relatives, which is well known from the youngest ages, so it's very good. Economic, social, educational, and health equity is probably achieved in most of the places in the country. Now, Nenets, they have quite very good, better access to economy because Randy Herden now is growing. It's profitable business. We have growing incomes of Randy Herders during last 7-8 years. It's due to the Chinese expansion. Chinese buy everything. So they prefer to buy animal parts for Chinese traditional medicine. So many animal parts they buy, not only meat. Meat is mostly consumed on a local area. And that's why it's growing. And it's also create conflict with oil and gas companies because people need more space, more territory. What is well known from the research, published research in the previous years, the diminishing alcohol consumption is the most effective suicide prevention program in modern history for males. It was done in Estonia. When Estonia joined European Union, they introduced European alcohol sale regulation and pricing policy. It dropped down alcohol consumption and dropped down alcohol suicide rate. Seriously dropped down. Before, Estonia was one of the leaders in Europe in suicide rate in 90s, for example. This is one of our intervention showing my family experience. It's my grandfather and me. Looks very traditionally. Right. My face is a bit different. So it's our island called Kalguyev. This was a property, not the island. Island was not a property. At the beginning of 20th century, before Russian Revolution, all the Rendis on Kalguyev, they were the property of my family. It was a big family of Randy Herders, and they also employ local indigenous Nenets to work. And that was a group around 100 people with families, and the number of Rendis was huge. Maybe several thousand, maybe more. I don't know exactly the exact figures. But the story was explained in the book of Vasily Golovanov. The Allen book is translated into French language only, in Russian and French. It should be understandable probably in Canada. But in English it will come maybe soon. It's original photo made at that time by our photographer Leitzinger from Arkhangelsk. So they prohibited delivery of alcohol for 20 years. Island was clean from alcohol. There were no any drop of alcohol at all. Even they drowned the boats trying to bring alcohol to the island. It was a real fight sometimes, yeah. Because other merchants, they tried to make this illegal trade using alcohol, and that was necessary to control, to secure the people. And there were no homicides, no suicides at all in that area during this 20-year period. After the Russian Revolution, situation comes back, so freedom came, and the first boat brought a huge amount of alcohol to the island. And the family was removed and disappeared in a difficult period of Russian history. Only few people survived, including my grandfather. My grandmother died from tuberculosis when my father was three years old only. So, what kind of the prevention activities I established now? First of all, there are a lot of local activities. We provide some courses, seminars for suicide prevention for school teachers, for school psychologists. We have school psychologists in all the schools. It's like family consultant. Then there is an experience of NGO called Community Health Partnership. It was a program of Médecins Sans Frontières. It's a well-known organization. And then organized courses for health mediators. It's usually women, very active women. Women are responsible for everything in tundra. They build a house, they stand, they take care of the kids, they provide food, they cook, they make clothes, all the dresses and everything, so shoes. So it's a hard work to be a woman. That's why the state pays salary for housekeeper for every indigenous woman who stay in tundra with family. They get salary for this work. It's just a minimal salary in territory, but it's something. And they also have a right to get pension. The pension age for indigenous housekeeper is 50 years. Starting from 50 years, yes. In 50, you are able to get your pension if you are an indigenous woman living in tundra. So, regional and federal alcohol laws were introduced. Then local prevention programs. In many, many regions, they have the local prevention programs, but only in alcohol and drug abuse. Suicide prevention is included in the sub-program or sub-chapter in this program. There are no suicide prevention program in Russia at all, and no strategy, unfortunately. So Red Cross is working mostly in Chukotka, very actively working with youth. We have crisis hotlines, I will show you later, and red button, so-called red button, it's a banner on a website of our outpatient clinic. You just click there and chat. So deliver your problem and getting some response. This is a successful project organized by my colleagues in Velsky, Vinogradovsky, Pinyashky, Shenkursky, four municipalities in Arkhangelsk region. They joined this program. All municipalities with high rate of suicide. It's non-indigenous territory. It's not an indigenous. But it's very applicable to any other. So it's very rural place, something between 200 and 500 kilometers from the city. So situation is close to Canadian. In 2010, we start to educate primary healthcare workers. David Goldberg, Linda Gask from UK, and Alla Zakroeva from Russia, they support this type of training. And 60 people completed, 60 primary healthcare workers from their municipalities. Next year, in 2011, we selected 15 tutors from this group. And they were trained by the same way, but more professionally. And they became a tutor team. Tutors start to train another healthcare workers and more wide group of gatekeepers, not only healthcare workers. We call it equal train equal. They provide 43 seminars and 185 people completed this course during 2 years. In the year 2014-15, Russia demonstrated the highest rates of suicides among the kids and adolescents. We were the leaders in the world. It's difficult to say why, but even the big report of WHO was published on this issue. One of the reasons, there were many reasons why it happened so, but one of the reasons was also related to the distribution of so-called death groups in the social network. In social networks, it's really the crime where some of the bad people moderate the young kids, young people to commit suicide. They created these death groups and forced the kids to commit suicide. And there are many, many cases in Russia were related with this. Not so many in my region. In our region, we had only three or four cases related of suicides related to the death groups, those groups' activities. Of course, police is trying to close this immediately. They usually search this social networking, but it does not work proper in all the 100%. It's very difficult to control social networking. Yes?
I'm just trying to understand how you would entice children to commit suicide. So is it that you, let's say, have somehow abused them?
No, they...
Or is it that they are sort of cult-like and they,
Yes. You know, the youth culture is very much related to the pride culture. It's like a pride, you know? In a pride or in a group of people united by one idea, sometimes crazy ideas are happening. It's one of the crazy ideas to be proud to commit suicide, to be the honored. And after committing suicide, this case is usually became an honor of this guy. It's widely distributed in the same network. So it's like, you know, sacrificing himself and make him saint person for this group. So it's terrible situation. We analyzed all the cases of suicides in my area, for example, and we discovered only few connected with the internet. So I don't think that internet is our enemy. It's our friend in thinking about suicide prevention. But this is a possible connection, and it's existing in the world, unfortunately. And now it's a crime. It's even included into the criminal code of Russia. So you will be punished immediately. And you will spend a hell of time in prison if you will create this death group. But before it wasn't. So in this period of time, in 14-15, children and youth intersectoral teams were created. We invited the tutors from Sweden, Lars Jakobsen and Jan Peter Sture. Jan Peter is a leader of youth suicide prevention in Sami population. Very nice guy, I know him very well. He is completing his PhD at the same university where I am. I've got my PhD degree in Tromsø, in the Arctic University of Norway. So he doing the same. In four teams and 25 completed, they developed some kind of the guidelines, algorithms of work. It was developed inside of the group, related to the same group. What kind of the gatekeepers? Gatekeepers are individuals in a community. Those who have face-to-face contact, everyday contact with large community members as a part of the usual routine. So it possibly can be owner of the shop or postman. It's teacher, health worker, social worker, psychologist, children care service officer. So, and they united in a team. They start working together. They were organizing many activities. So you see the pictures from the seminars, teamwork. Then here they create their own algorithm of work, how to manage in a concrete situation on site, related to personal attitude, to personality. You, and you. What you should do, how we can contact, what kind of the problem, how we can solve this problem with family, and so on. They created their own guidelines and leaflets. Here is a role play. I don't know what this lady is doing, but it's a kind of the role. Probably she is committing suicide. Maybe. And here you see the activity, actions. This action is called You Are Not Alone, which is a sign on the back of the t-shirt. You are not alone. And this is the result. What's happened later? So suicide rate in adolescents in the territory dropped down. And now it's something between 5 and 6, which is a moderate. 5 and 6 for 100,000 kids from the same group. In the same group. Later, another project was have started. That project was a bit more expensive. This is much cheaper. This is much cheaper because it's only web consulting, interaction, webinars, supervision, things you can get. Our psychiatrists don't have enough education in psychiatry. Our GPs, sorry, don't have connection with psychiatry. Psychiatrists, they have district system. For example, my son, he is working as a district psychiatrist, and he is responsible for 70,000 of city population, 70,000. One. It's called district psychiatry. So that makes our GPs a bit nervous. So we have district physician, same like district like general practitioner. And we organize courses for them in different areas. It's called POMOR program, POMOR project. POMOR project is kind of, it's a kind of the area around White Sea called POMOR. We are POMORs living in this area, if we live in this area. So this is a list of the topics, especially for these primary healthcare physicians. And inside of that project, also very interesting tool was introduced called SPIFA, Structured Psychiatric Interview for General Practice, very useful instrument which is used in mostly in the Scandinavian countries. Now we have it in Russia, in Russian language. Very strong, very useful for primary health care only. So crisis hotlines are here. I just want to show you alcohol sales. What time you can buy alcohol in the regions of Russia. Very different situation. Even the week ago, we discussed it in Narianmar, in the capital of Nenets. The police was asking to open, to close the stores, alcohol shops during the at least twice a year when Nenets people are coming to sell the meat, and it's usually connected with suicides, homicides, and crimes, but it doesn't work. Community should say, we want or we don't want. And of course, there are many factors which slow down and prohibited implementation of suicide prevention. So here is my list. I'm just moving further. List of some papers we have published on this issue and also a chapter in the book. I called this chapter Pandemic of Arctic Suicidality. It's a book about pandemics, which was published last year, in the fall of the year in New York. So it's real pandemic people. And all the countries should be united in the struggle with suicide. I guess it's possible. At least this man support this idea by the words, you may never know what results come from your actions, but if you do nothing, there will be no results. So thank you. This is my email. I'm sorry for Russian at the end, but it's time scale. Ready for questions? Please. Not yet, but I'm very much interested in it. Not yet. No, it's, you know, it's very small amount of activities we provided for suicide prevention. And just a few things in the country. Very little. Mm-hmm. Colonization was one of the forces. Yeah. On the basis of colonization, this growth of suicide rate was happening. So it's clear. When we destroy traditional lifestyle and remove suicide protective things like lifestyle, language, access to language everywhere, connectedness, feeling of connectedness. Now, sense of belonging means not so much. If you belong to the nation, it does not mean, if you even know language and belong to the nation, it's not enough. I know the newest psychological research explaining that it's much more relevant to have sense of connectedness than sense of belonging. Sense of belonging is just a slogan. But sense of connectedness, if you are connected, how we can be connected? Only by language. Common occupation, traditional lifestyle, and language. Language is a force. And of course, we have lost many of the things. Due to colonization, of course, it's a type of colonization. Even the activity of oil and gas companies, it's also colonization. It's a new term, I heard not so far, environmental racism. Environmental racism, yes.
And also, I think you mentioned if there's family that have committed suicide, then it passes on to the offspring or to the youth or children?
Yes, there are some families, family histories, of course, yes. We also have a film which was broadcasted several years ago in a territory. A film called Canyon Crossroad. It's about a story about Nenets who committed a crime, but he is from the small village where mostly indigenous people live in. And there is a report from the cemetery. The girl is going across the cemetery and telling the stories about the cases. Most of the men on the cemetery, they committed suicide or homicide or died being heavily drunk. So and alcohol was one of the most terrible thing around this story. So it's also the artificial settlement, how we call it, forced settlement.
Mm-hmm. If there was that happening in our community, then people are called in to come and do some kind of awareness or talk to the community members. And usually there are elders in the community that come and support the ones that are left behind, postvention, they call it,
mm-hmm.
where they speak to the ones that have lost someone. So would that kind of a method of healing for them, or that process of grieving, they can get that help so it can be transferred to the other members of the family to kind of prevent that from happening again.
Mm-hmm.
That's the traditional way. Is that what you're saying with the indigenous community? Do you call them reserves, for example?
No. No, we have no reserves. Even we tried to introduce, there was a period of history and was an attempt to introduce the same type of reserve, but it was called in a different way. It's cultural community settlements or something close, but it wasn't introduced in Russia, no. It's not a reserve. And never been in a history. What we have introduced is residential schools. Residential schools are still existing, but it's not obligatory to go. You just a decision of parents, and they also don't take the smallest one. Smallest, they can go to the so-called nomadic school which is moving together with Randy Hurden families. And the people, kids are staying in the same family. They can stay in the school, for example, for a week, then return back on weekends, or they can go every day. It depends on the distance from nomadic school to the site. So now many of the nenes, they have good snowmobiles, so they can go fast, much faster than before. Randys sometimes are not very useful in this way. So it's much faster to use snowmobile, snow bike, right? Mm-hmm. Good question. First place where you can get knowledge is a school. In the indigenous territory, it's a second language obligatory to learn. Yes, obligatory to learn in the indigenous territories. And for indigenous people, it's a good support first. Then there are textbooks in the indigenous languages for primary school only. We have no textbooks on the Nenets language on mathematics, for example, or more difficult subjects like chemistry, physics, it's useless. But in the basis, they have textbooks in the indigenous language about culture, stories, history, for example, which is provided in school. At school first. Not many of the territories in Russia, they have this equally to all the languages. But Nenets have their own stable territories where they can provide this. It's not everywhere. In Chukotka, I know, yes. In Nenets, yes. In Sakha, also.
What kind of research evaluation methodology do you use for this? I think a realist evaluation comes to mind in terms of how you would evaluate the impact of this intervention at a time when there may be multiple other things happening and changing at times.
Mm-hmm. Good question. Last year, we have published in the journal Psychiatry Services a paper on evaluation of suicide prevention programs, which was created together in the inside of the project called Rising Sun. Have you heard about it? You can click and get this paper easily. It was published in October last year. It's a big group of people from Russia, Norway, Sweden. From Russia, probably only me, yes. But many people from US. And the group was led by American Institute of Mental Health. So this is a methodology we have used also. We introduce it in Russia. It's existing in all the languages. It's existing in Russian, in English, probably in Inuit language too, because they plan to translate. So well.
Thank you, Yury, for your presence.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. If somebody interested, I can send you the answers on your questions by email. Please contact me.